You're listening to the audio production of My Sunday Best, Pearls of Wisdom, Wit, Grace, and Style by Dr. Laverne Ford Wimberly with Barbranda Lumpkins Walls, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Machelle Williams. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
To my parents, Jesse Eugene Ford and Clydie Vernice Smith Ford, my husband, James Oliver Wimberly, and sister, Jewel Vernice Maynard, for their enduring encouragement, love, and support. Thanks for helping me soar. I am eternally grateful. Introduction. It all started with the pandemic. I never miss going to church on Sunday. So on March 29, 2020, the first Sunday that my beloved Metropolitan Baptist Church in Tulsa had a virtual worship service because of the pandemic, I knew that giving honor and glory to God in my bathrobe or workout gear was not an option. I was raised to present myself to the Lord wearing my very best. At 82 years old, I couldn't start being a slouch before God, even though I was alone at home. So, just like any other Sunday, I got up and got dressed. The song, "Brighten the Corner Where You Are," that I learned in church when I was a child, came to mind. It's still one of my favorites today. The words resonate with me, and maybe with you too. Brighten the corner where you are. Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. To the many duties ever near you now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Refrain. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Just above the clouded skies that you may help to clear, let not narrow self your way debar. Though into one heart alone may fall your song of cheer, brighten the corner where you are. Here for all your talent you may surely find a need. Here reflect the bright and morning star. Even from your humble hand the bread of life may feed. Brighten the corner where you are. Ina Dooley Ogden, 1912, Public Domain. With that song running through my mind, I put on a wide-brim, frilly white hat, a simple white blouse with eyelet inserts, a turquoise skirt, and matching turquoise jewelry. I'm usually more formally attired for an in-person service, but I thought it would be fun to snap a selfie and post it on Facebook. I let folks know that I was ready to worship and encourage them to do the same. Some of my fellow church members are Facebook friends, and this was my way to brighten their spirits and mine and stay connected during a time of sudden isolation and despair for many people. After posting that first selfie, I kept doing it. Week after week, I got up on Sunday morning and put on a different outfit and a different hat and snapped a photo of myself. In the ninth week, I started to add a scripture or inspirational message. I never imagined that more than a year would go by before my church resumed in-person services. For 52 consecutive Sundays, I posted a picture of myself on Facebook, dressed in my Sunday best, and I never repeated a hat or an outfit. After 52 weeks, our church had its last virtual worship service, and on March 21, 2021, I posted my final Sunday selfie. Kim Jackson, a reporter for Tulsa's KTUL ABC Channel 8, is a member of Metropolitan and saw my post. Several times before, Kim had asked to interview me about my career as an educator, and I'd always said no. This time, I said yes and agreed to do a Zoom interview. The mainstream media caught wind of it, and the response was overwhelming. Some outlets mentioned me and others interviewed me. Here are some of the places I appeared. Anderson Cooper's Full Circle on CNN, Fox News, The Washington Post, Tulsa World, ABC News, MSNBC, CBS News, Today Show, Trevor Noah. Dan Rather even mentioned me on Twitter. People from all over the world have said my selfies and words of encouragement have blessed and inspired them. Then the gifts started to arrive. See the accompanying PDF to see some of the wonderful presents I received. I never imagined my Sunday best selfies would stir up such love from total strangers. A couple from New York sent me $50. How about that? I am supremely grateful for each gift. I awoke this morning with devout thanksgiving for my friends, the old and the new. Ralph Waldo Emerson. Then someone called and asked if I wanted to do a book. My motto is, think before you act. That was written on a plaque hanging on the chalkboard in every single classroom at my alma mater, George Washington Carver Junior High. I still adhere to that motto. I take my time before acting on something. I think about the consequences and the ramifications of my actions. As my mother used to say, he who acts as his own attorney has a fool for a client. I took my time and thought about writing a book. Eventually, I said yes, because God has allowed me to live a glorious life. I never dreamed I'd do a book, but I'm a natural encourager and hope I can encourage you and brighten the corner where you are. Wisdom, wit, grace, and style. Home. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. I come from humble beginnings. I was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma on January 29, 1939, to the best parents this side of heaven. My dad, Jesse Eugene Ford, and mom, Clydie Smith Ford, were my first examples of strength, courage, resourcefulness, and godliness. They also gave my older sister, Jewel, and me a strong foundation of faith. Dad and mother were loving, but they had high expectations for us. Jewel and I strived to please them and make them proud. My father was a mechanic who suffered a debilitating stroke in his 40s and couldn't work after that. My mother, a domestic worker for a wealthy white family in Tulsa, picked up the slack. Not only did my mother go to work every day, she also took great care of my dad, my sister, and me, and did so without complaint. Mother could stretch a dollar like nobody's business and never missed any event or activity that involved Jewel and me. I had an idyllic childhood. Yes, it was that good. We were poor, but I didn't know it. I grew up in Tulsa's Greenwood District, home of the renowned Black Wall Street, with its many Black-owned and operated businesses. We had everything we needed within walking distance: stores, cleaners, pharmacies, hair salons, barbershops, restaurants, movie theaters, doctors, dentists, and churches. That community was like a family. They stepped up and filled in the gap, especially when my father was ill and couldn't do the things that other fathers did for their children. Teachers and neighbors escorted my sister and me to events like father-daughter banquets. We had that village support, a nucleus who wrapped their arms around us. We looked out for each other. Greenwood District, Black Wall Street. I am proud of who I am and where I come from. The historic Greenwood District in Tulsa, Oklahoma, also known as Black Wall Street. In the 1900s, the Greenwood District was developing into what became North America's most prosperous African-American community. Sadly, the neighborhood was primarily destroyed by a race riot, May 31st through June 1st, 1921. Known as the Tulsa Race Massacre, 75 to 300 African-Americans were killed, 2,000 businesses were destroyed, and 10,000 people became homeless. Greenwood Cultural Center website. Several years later, the neighborhood was rebuilt, and the seeds of entrepreneurship, community, faith, and family remained vital for decades. I knew families who worked hard to build businesses on Tulsa's Black Wall Street in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. They wanted to leave a legacy for their children and grandchildren. But urban renewal came through in the 1960s and 70s and wiped out most of the Black businesses. Some people tried to rebuild, but so many who came from the families of those original entrepreneurs didn't have the drive or desire to follow in their ancestors' footsteps. I am the chairperson of the board of directors of the Greenwood Cultural Center, GCC. In 2021, we commemorated the 100th anniversary of the massacre with various ceremonies and events that included the three known survivors and various government officials and celebrities. Youngsters must know their history and carry on the legacy. Knowing the history of how we overcame as a people and how we made it through difficult times needs to be emphasized, especially to the younger generation. In life, we have to press on despite obstacles and keep going. When I was at Carver Junior High, my teacher, Mrs. M. O. Williams, read us a poem called "Keep a Goin'" by Frank Stanton and encouraged us to memorize it. That poem made such an impact on me that, after I became a teacher, I hung it on the wall of all my classrooms. By God's grace and with His help, we must keep going. Keep a going. If you strike a thorn or rose, keep a going. If it hails or if it snows, keep a going. 'Tain't no use to sit and whine when the fish ain't on your line. Bait your hook and keep a trying. Keep a going. When the weather kills your crop, keep a going. When you tumble from the top, keep a going. Suppose you're out of every dime. Being so ain't any crime. Tell the world you're feeling prime. Keep a going. When it looks like all is up, keep a going. Drain the sweetness from the cup. Keep a going. See the wild birds on the wing. Hear the bells that sweetly ring. When you feel like sighing, sing. Keep a going. Frank Levy Stanton, 1900, Public Domain. Worship. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Psalm 95, verse 6. Since early childhood, worshiping on Sunday has been a major part of my life. I subscribe to Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6 that says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." King James Version. My parents made sure we were grounded in our Christian faith. We attended Union Baptist Church, where I started to learn all about worshiping the Lord. I am now a member of Metropolitan Baptist Church, where I serve as chairwoman of the Board of Trustees. I grew up in the church, and I never strayed from it. For years when I traveled, I looked for a Sunday worship service wherever I was, even in airports. I just felt something wasn't right unless I had that weekly worship experience. One of the most memorable worship experiences I had was when I visited the Holy Land in 2014. I had a deep sense that Jesus was right there with me at the Garden Tomb, the site of His burial and resurrection. Oh, what a feeling that was! I had never missed a Sunday in church until COVID-19 swept in and shut down most places of worship. But as you know, even a pandemic didn't stop me from worshiping God. My family room or office became my makeshift sanctuary as I sat alone, dressed in my Sunday best, with my laptop to tune in to the online services. I was overjoyed to return to in-person worship at Metropolitan Baptist after a year. I sat in my usual spot, the last row in section 2, seat 1, surrounded by my church family. I was right back where I belonged, worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth. Gracious God, may my worship of you be acceptable in your sight. You are truly worthy of all praise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.